Thank you very much. On behalf of the Entrepreneurship Forum and the VINNOVA, the Swedish Government Agency for Innovation, I'm also happy to welcome you to this seminar, which I think will be extremely interesting. I don't think it will need a lot of guidance. I think it will guide itself. As has been mentioned before, from Europe to China to Brazil to the US, all the governments are proclaiming the vital importance of innovation for growth, prosperity, and for tackling societal challenges. Xi Jinping talks about innovation-driven development, or innovation as the soul of national advancement. And Obama talks about out-innovating the world, and that the nation that goes all in on innovation today will own the global economy tomorrow. So innovation, I think everybody here can agree, is not a force of nature. It's not like oil or gold. You either have it or you don't. It's something that's shaped by conditions, by contexts, by resources, and by policies. And the question, as Pontus was saying, the real question, I think, for governments today is what should be the role of the state? Is it, as you said, to address market failure, to ensure that you provide funding for basic research and lean back and let the government, the invisible hand, do its magic, or is there something more? And I can think of no better person to address this issue than Mariana Mazzucato. She is a professor who holds the R.M. Phillips Chair in the Economics of Innovation at SPRU, Science Policy Research Unit at the University of Sussex. She was educated at Tufts undergraduate and did her PhD at the New School for Social Research in New York. And as most of you in this room will know, she wrote the book The Entrepreneurial State, which has been, among others, on the Financial Times list of books of the year for 2013. I think the same for Forbes and for Huffington Post. So I think we can all look forward to a very inspiring talk. The format of the seminar today is that after Professor Mazzucato's speech, there will be three panelists who will comment on the presentation, and then we will give Mariana Mazzucato a chance to react, and then I would also invite questions from the audience, short questions, since we only have 1.5 hours and we've already used 7 minutes. So please, short, clear questions addressed to Mariana so we can have a fruitful discussion. So having said that, I would like to welcome Mariana.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I actually didn't realize this was going to be just me. I came and I said, so what happened before? What's happening after? And they said, no, it's just you. So I'm glad I actually showed up on time, which we risked. Now I'm not about to make a phone call. I'm just putting on the stopwatch. I don't have a clicker.
There's right there.
Sorry.
Okay.
Great. Okay. So what I want to do is, besides debunk all sorts of myths, but that's already in the title, so that won't be a surprise, is actually to argue that talking about innovation is not enough. Talking about the state is not enough. What we actually need is a framework through which to do it. We need to think big. And unfortunately, around the world, not only do we have what was just said, which is lots of talk about the state just having sort of, you know, to get out of the way, but the existing framework through which then states and different state agencies are operating is a pretty static framework. So even when they're trying to do really exciting things, they're being, if you want, impeded to do more magical, high impact things. And I'm definitely gonna be talking about the state as along with the private sector, but let me just say two things. One is when I use the word state, I am actually talking mainly about a decentralized network state, different types of public sector agencies. If we have time at the end, I'd like to give you some examples even from, say, the BBC, right? The British Public Broadcasting Agency, how it's thought about innovation. So I'm not talking about sort of big brother top down. That's important to say. Hopefully it'll come across in the examples. But I'm also going to be talking about the state alongside the private sector. Okay, so the state alone cannot do it, the private sector alone cannot do it. What we actually need to be building are symbiotic, mutualistic ecosystems. The reason I use the word ecosystem is because that's now the trendy word that's used by all sorts of ministers and heads of also transnational organizations when they talk about the need to build public-private partnerships. We often hear this word ecosystem, and the problem is, as you know, ecosystems can also be predator prey. They can be parasitic. So the question that I really want to be, if you want, honing in on throughout the talk is what kind of ecosystem do we actually want to build? And in that sense, again, coming back to what kind of framework is needed to actually talk about these partnerships. Now, why do I have this sort of, you know, figure up here as my first slide? It's because all of a sudden, you know, to be honest, for Sweden, this is kind of old news. So I have to remember who I'm actually talking to. You guys are like a pretty cool country, right? I'm often talking to basket case countries like my own, the UK, or even worse, Italy, where I'm actually from, in terms of innovation. You guys are actually pretty good on this front. However, you know, industrial policy, innovation policy has actually been sort of a bad word, almost a blasphemy, for many years, and now it's back, right? It's back. Everyone's talking about it. Even Cameron, even Osborne, Renzi, even Berlusconi talked about industrial policy. Why? Because of this whole issue, which is basically the financial crisis, which is just how financialized, well, especially in the US and the UK, but because financial markets are global, the whole world, how financialized many different countries became. In other words, how much financial intermediation the financial sector actually outpaced completely what's often talked about in terms of the real economy. So this is, this red line shows you the percentage of gross value added made up of just literally financial intermediation. The other one, the real economy, which is everything but finance and agriculture. This is the data for the UK. It's even worse in the US. And so the idea is that we need things like innovation policy and smart innovation-led growth to rebalance the economy, you know, away from finance towards industry, away from the takers towards the makers. And, you know, even though that's sort of a sexy way to talk about the need for industrial policy, it's problematic, and I'll be coming back to this at the end. Why is it problematic? It's problematic because it completely mythologizes and ignores just how financialized the makers have become, the real economy, right? This is not about finance versus industry. This is a much broader problem about financialization, like how much of profits of the private sector are actually being reinvested into the economy in areas like human capital, R&D, et cetera. So this is just to say, yes, innovation policy is back because of this problem. However, we need to be careful because if innovation policy doesn't also tackle the financialization of the real economy, and hence actually having financial market reform and innovation policy and issues around corporate governance working hand in hand, it ain't gonna do much. And so, you know, why did I start off before talking about big thinking? Well, that rebalancing that's needed to go towards, you know, creating this innovation-led growth that is somehow gonna rebalance away from finance towards the real stuff, as well as the bigger ambitions, which is growth that is not only, if you want, smart, but also inclusive and sustainable, actually really require all sorts of, you know, very active public policies. But I would say that the biggest battle in terms of actually tackling these, you know, things that, again, are out there in the media. Obama talks about it. I'm sure your prime minister talks about this in terms of inclusive growth, sustainable growth, smart growth, requires extremely active state. And yet the biggest battle is precisely that. What do we actually know about the role of the state in the economy? And the answer is not much. Why? Well, I put this wonderful quote here of Keynes, who basically says, you know, the real issue is how much policymaking is actually guided by sort of defunct theory, which then he went on to explain why he thought it was defunct. But I would argue that nowhere, you know, nowhere more than areas like innovation policy do we actually see this issue of sort of defunct, pretty static, old school theories of the role of public policy really limiting what policymakers, the practical people, actually do. This first quote up here is actually quite good, and I think it's been completely ignored by the Keynesians themselves. So people like Paul Krugman, Joe Stiglitz, who write a lot, you know, in important papers on why it's so wrong that today we have pro-cyclical governments kind of acting like business, right? Government should be counter-cyclical. That was Keynes's whole point. People like Krugman and Stiglitz talk a lot about that. But I would say, and again, I'll come back to this, that what they and others have been ignoring is sort of Keynes's real big message, which is that what government should be doing are kind of the really difficult, ambitious, visionary, mission-oriented areas, not just making things a little bit better or a little bit worse, but really just kind of tackling, you know, what's not being done at all. And this is the issue that, you know, what is not being done at all? How do we talk about that? And hence, how do we delineate the space that it's correct for the state to be, if you want, interacting within? Well, there's basically sort of three, and this is, you know, very simplistic, but I'll just go over it quickly. There's three key ways that this is talked about. One, of course, is, you know, we'll get the hell out of the way. We don't need you, state. And I'm basically not going to be talking about that here because we're all adults and, you know, this is not the Tea Party congregation. So I will, you know, not even talk about that if you want view. But there's the more standard view, which is, oh, of course we need the state. We need it to sort of create the conditions, right? We need it to set the level playing field, you know, invest in the infrastructure and skills and research and the roads. And then, yeah, get out of the way. I took out a lot of slides because I thought I had less than 30 minutes. So I usually put up a great quote from The Economist, which has constantly sort of puts across this position, which is, you know, stick to the basic state and then get out of the way and leave the rest to the revolutionaries. They actually had this wonderful editorial in The Economist recently where they were dedicating it to the next big thing after the internet. So it was all about nanotechnology, brain stuff, the green technology revolution. And they said, well, what should we learn from the past? Yes, the state, of course, is needed, but it has to learn when to get out of the way so the really innovative stuff can happen. The other way that actually economists talk about it is much more specific, which is that the state is important to fix different types of market failures. This was also just talked about before in the introduction. What is a market failure? It's when, if you want, the market, the business sector does not provide. I shouldn't actually say market slash business sector because the market is not business. The market is an outcome of interactions between different agents, some of which are business, some are public sector, households. I'll come back again to that as well, because that's extremely important. But yeah, so when business does not provide, for example, when you have a public good, so say basic research, which has very high spillovers, it's very hard to appropriate the returns to investments in areas like basic research, then you have too little private sector investment, and hence the state should, you know, come in and invest in that area. So there's very little debate, actually, in most countries on whether the state should be, in fact, funding R&D in terms of the basic research side. That doesn't mean that every country does that, but that isn't sort of an area of debate. And so what I want to focus on is both this problem of R&D and who's actually doing it, but also, you know, is this actually completely missing something else that the state has done in the few countries, because there are few, the few regions within countries that have actually historically achieved what we call sort of innovation-led growth, smart growth. And I'm going to argue, yes, this basically, you know, even if we look at market failures, whether it's public goods or positive and negative externalities, if the state was just limiting itself to those areas, we actually would not be able to explain whether it's the Silicon Valley of the past, China today, Finland, lots of Sweden's success, Brazil, the few emerging countries that really are emerging. I really don't like the word BRICS. You know, Brazil and Russia, how different are they in terms of how they approach innovation? Hugely different. And so by ignoring that something more interesting thing that I'm going to be talking about, we unfortunately constantly come back to this sort of mythological distinction where, yes, of course, we need the state to do all, you know, the kind of boring basic stuff, creating the conditions as well as the horizontal framework measures, but then get the hell out of the way because they're really cool guys, whether it's the individuals like Steve Jobs, Elon Musk, Zuckerberg, or say the venture capital industry can really do their funky stuff. And so this ends up leading to policies, really dysfunctional policies, I think, which kind of assume that what you have is business in a cage, wanting to innovate, wanting to be creative, wanting to invest. I wish that ANC was here because you got to hear this guy talk. He's saying exactly this for Italy. You have Italian business wanting to invest, but it's being impeded by too much red tape, too much bureaucracy, too much task, too many rules. So what we need is to think of different ways that government can facilitate that innovation process and take away all these barriers so it can roar. Instead, what I'll be arguing is, you know, that actually what we have in many sectors and many countries is, you know, not much courage. And if we actually look at what has led to both private and public working together in a really interesting, creative, symbiotic way, has actually required the state to create the animal spirits, using Keynes's word, not to assume them, create that courage, create that willingness, and only by taking on this kind of entrepreneurial, mission-oriented, visionary role from the public sector does the private sector later enter these different spaces. And the only way I can really sort of, you know, convince you about this is by giving you some examples. Ooh, this is completely self-promotion, sorry. This is my book. The reason I have the lion and the pussycat is the reason I just mentioned, which is, you know, the word animal spirits, if you don't know what it is, it's being misused, by the way, today. It's assumed to mean just kind of behavioral finance, you know, so irrational exuberance. Robert Shiller, who won the Nobel Prize, wrote a lot about that. What Keynes actually said is that what drives business investment are animal spirits. And what he meant by that was that it's not enough to talk about tax and interest, you know, lowering those. And that's going to, if you want, increase investment, which is the most volatile part of GDP, right? GDP has these four parts of demand, consumption, private investment, government spending, and net exports. The I part, if you actually just plot them, it's the most volatile. And he said it's procyclical and volatile because it's determined by animal spirits. And so if you actually look at the innovation literature, what's really interesting is we see that what drives investment is the perception of where the future opportunities are, and there's very little correlation with tax and interest rates. This is, again, an area that the modern-day Keynesians, even though I very much support this, you know, again, this notion that we have to have counter-cyclical government, it's not enough to stop there. We actually have to understand the way that government has actually created these animal spirits, in other words, created that instinct from business that there is a future market or technological opportunity. This role of government in doing that has no words in economics. So lots of what I'll be talking about has actually been inspired by a historian slash sociologist, Carl Polanyi, in this wonderful book he wrote called The Great Transformation, where he really showed over the course of capitalism, which is only about 250, 300 years old, so it's not some sort of, you know, natural, universal, historical system that's always been there. It's been 300 years old, and the capitalist market was actually, he says in this wonderful historic book about the history of capitalism, actually formed and shaped and forced by government. So the whole state versus market thing is actually false historically from the start, and nowhere do we see this as true as in, say, if you want, the innovation arena. But what's really important about his work is he shows that even just in terms of the market itself, the market mechanism, the notion that there is an average price of oranges in a country, that market mechanism was in fact strongly shaped by government. And so basically what I'm gonna be contrasting in as much time as I can, is this notion that somehow all we're doing is fixing markets versus that what we're doing in terms of an active public sector is actually shaping and creating markets. And if you buy this, and if, you know, this becomes, if you want, a way to guide governments, what it means is we also need different tools through which to evaluate the government investments. Lots of these sort of attacks that we hear on some of the successful agencies, whether it's DARPA in the US or the China Development Bank or KfW or the TSB in the UK, of crowding out the business sector. If you actually look really deep into the accusations or even the picking winners critique that we often hear, they stem very precisely from a notion that all government should be doing is, if you want, putting patches here and there, and if it steps out of bounds, obviously it's sort of taking the place of the business sector. If you have a notion that somehow what government's doing is actively creating and shaping a market, then the way you would evaluate it should be linked to some sort of quantitative tools and also qualitative, which can determine the degree to which you have done that. And if you haven't, perhaps then you failed. If you were just working within existing markets and perhaps then taking the place of what the private sector should be doing, fine, you're crowding out. But if you can have some tools that can actually measure and evaluate the degree to which you're really pushing the frontier and shaping and creating markets, not just fixing them, that should, again, if you want, trickle down to these evaluation, these new ways to evaluate. Okay, so let me just get to some of these examples. when I talk about innovation, I'm not talking about incremental changes from, say, the iPhone 4 to the iPhone 5. I've tried to learn some lessons from the emergence, if you want, of the really important technologies that some people talk about in terms of general purpose technology. So those technologies and innovations that have really affected how all different sectors work across the economy. And looking at them in terms of sort of a risk landscape, so not everything's the same. Who's investing when and where within these sectors? So in green today, who's investing in the most capital intensive and high technological and market risk? That upper right hand quadrant, I'll have some figures later for green. I focus on in the book, but also many examples when I talk around Europe on Silicon Valley. Am I making that noise or is it them? Is it me going like that? Use that one? So can I just take this off since it really bothers me? Okay. Here, you can do it while I'm So now you'll see my hair, all my hair come out. Right, so why do I focus? Am I still there? Okay, luckily I don't really have a hairdo, so there's nothing to mess up. I have four little kids, so any attempt I make at looking semi like Sophia Loren never works. right, so now I gotta stay near here, I guess. The reason I focus on Silicon Valley is, of course, the big question in Europe, even before the crisis, has always been sort of, you know, why are all these really funky companies like Amazon, Google, and Apple coming out of the US? And this use of Silicon Valley as sort of a metaphorical dream place is still extremely strong. And so actually learning the real lesson that we should be learning from a place like Silicon Valley and places that today are sort of emulating that is important. In the UK, we have something called the Silicon Roundabout in London's East End, where we're trying to, again, copy that kind of ecosystem. Now, what's interesting, if you look at different, if you want, areas that have, in fact, come out of that part of the world, first of all, what you find is that you had, yes, not just an active state, with huge amounts of money funding things, like, you know, the classic example, the internet funded mainly, not only by DARPA, but that these investments, the public investments, happened across the entire innovation chain. This notion that somehow it was just the public good, so the basic research stuff that was important, is just wrong. You see in, whether it's, again, in energy, in the internet today, on the kind of investments that have facilitated Tesla's emergence, that it, you know, these were investments across, again, the entire chain, where you have, say, ARPA-E, which is coming out of the Department of Energy in the US, trying to do today for renewables what DARPA, its sister organization, did for the internet, funding not just basic research but lots of applied research. You have that Small Business Innovation Research Program doing a lot of early stage seed financing of companies, mainly but not only through procurement. You have the National Institutes of Health that spend $32 billion a year doing, again, not just basic research, but also often bringing the drugs all the way down to even doing, for example, clinical trials, and spending a lot also, again, on the applied research. So this notion that somehow it's just the public good basic research example that can explain the importance of the public sector, just, again, looking across these different agencies already, we see that it's problematic. But what I find most interesting is, you know, a program like the Small Business Innovation Research Program, which, again, provides early-stage seed financing to companies, not only has been important, but it's been increasingly important over time. This isn't obvious, right? In an advanced capitalist country, you would think that you would have, say, a venture capital sector that would be then taking that role. And in fact, that's why we have the venture capital industry, because banks, private banks, are too risk averse. And so we need this early stage high risk finance. The problem is, if you actually look at what's happened to venture capital over time, by hyping it up, and again, we can go into that later, perhaps in question time, it's become increasingly short termist, exit driven, wanting to exit maximum sort of 3 to 5 years time, mainly not only through an IPO or a buyout, when actually that whole innovation, if you want, cycle, and even the middle stage can take 10 to 15 years. And so as the private financial sector, in this case VC, has become increasingly short-termist, speculative through the whole IPO dynamics, this public funding, which here is these, but anyway, the shades look a bit similar, has become more important. And of course, you know, Compaq, Intel got their early stage financing from SBIR, Apple got early stage financing from SBIC, a sister program. And a recent study by Block and Keller actually went and interviewed lots of companies in the US who then admit that when they go to venture capital, they're told first go get the SBIR funds and then come back. And again, this is simply not known. And it's a problem, of course, because that kind of financing is extremely risky, often fails, and unless we admit this high risk that that finance actually took, when it actually succeeds, there should be measures in place to make sure that some of this financing actually can, you know, make some of the returns from the upside precisely to be financing the downside. This isn't, by the way, just the only program. There's all sorts of early stage financing of companies, not just technology, in the US. So the Tesla S car most recently got $500 million guaranteed loan. This is different from the Obama administration. $465 million. And Solyndra, you know, similar company within renewables, got $500 million. Everyone knows the Solyndra story because it failed. It's now used as the classical example of government being basket case, doesn't know how to pick winners, you know, should just be doing the horizontal measures, ignoring the fact that actually, you know, Tesla, which is the new hero company in Silicon Valley, received a similar amount. And more or less for government, just like for venture capital, the statistics are that basically for every win, you've got kind of 7, 8, 9 losses. But whereas we admit that with VC, so that Genentech, for example, which was funded by Kleiner Perkins, you know, was very successful and made enough money for Kleiner Perkins to even fund its losses, which, you know, were, as with any venture capital company, quite high. Since we don't admit this kind of risk-taking role that the government plays, we haven't actually allowed in the U.S., this is different, by the way, in places like Finland or Israel, to also get some of the upside. And again, that's something that we might want to talk about. Israel, of course, the Yozma program, which does retain equity. In Finland, Citra, which, you know, funded the early stage Nokia, at least early stage meaning Nokia's sort of second development in the last 100 years, retained equity. And that's not sort of considered okay in the US and in sort of the more Anglo-Saxon type innovation ecosystems. Anyway, the iPhone, this is a classical example I use because, again, you know, what actually makes this phone smart and not stupid was, in fact, or is what you can do with it. So internet, GPS, touchscreen, Siri, all government funded. And it's not enough to say, okay, yeah, we know that. The question is, well, why is it then that in this, you know, 700-page biography of Steve Jobs, there's not one page, one paragraph, one sentence, one word that says, you know, that talks about that. That yes, he was a genius. We don't have enough people like that. Lots of countries would be better off with that kind of mind and that kind of team that he was able to put together, which still exists today. What we don't admit that's what is actually missing in many countries is not just the Steve Jobses, but this massive wave of state funding, which someone like himself was able to surf. And so, in fact, the R&D expenditures in Apple are actually quite low compared to some of their main competitors. Why? Because they use existing technology, put it together using, you know, Jobs's and Ives and that whole team's sense of design and simplicity. So he took that great calligraphy class. We all know that from the biography. And that, you know, was very important. But again, if you look at many countries around Europe, which are spending lower than average on R&D, both in terms of the public sector spending, but also, as we can discuss later, the private sector spending, that is really crucially important in the US, where you have this very active government across the entire chain, allowing then venture capitalists to come in sort of halfway through and ride that wave. And what we're missing today, even in places like the US, after all this sort of stalemate with the Tea Party dynamics, if you want, is if you want stable funding of that wave. Often when I talk about this around Europe, they all say, oh my God, you're talking about, you know, the military industrial complex, you know, because they see things like the CIA having been involved in the touch screen. By the way, the CIA has the biggest venture capital fund in the US called InQtel. So yeah, you know, DARPA out of the Department of Defense, that worries many people. But the point is that became a model in the US that was then applied to health. This is the $32 billion a year that I mentioned before, which has actually been responsible for the most radical drugs, these new molecular entities with priority rating, so the revolutionary drugs, but also areas like health, like energy, which I'll mention in just a second. So again, ARPA-E within the Department of Energy trying to do really cool things like DARPA did for the internet. I should also say that one thing that really distinguishes these organizations is the degree to which they've been able to attract really high-level talent, right? So the Department of Energy, up until recently, was run by a Nobel Prize-winning physicist called Steve Chu. And this is one of the issues, that the more we actually, you know, downplay the role of what the state's supposed to do, you know, just fix market failures, you know, help facilitate the business sector, or, you know, just create the conditions or get the hell out of the way, you know, it becomes really hard to attract the best. And I don't have this notion of sort of who the best is, but, you know, the top talent out of universities, it's not very sexy in many countries to go work for the public sector, precisely because the way we talk about it has become, I think, quite problematic. And this is, of course, an issue, because it's not that the state is always like this. As I mentioned at the beginning, and, you know, I live in Italy, public sector organizations are not playing this role in Italy. But you get into this self-fulfilling prophecy where then the more we bash the state in terms of being the problem, just get out of the way, just reduce the tax, you know, do our R&D tax incentives and then get out, or create these conditions. You know, if you're a top scientist, why the hell would you want to go work in an organization that at best is facilitating, or even worse, de-risking, right? You know, is what DARPA did de-risk the internet sector so that business could come in, or did it actually create it and actually take that courage and the huge risk? Because for every internet, you have kind of 8 to 9 Concords, as I mentioned before. So the language we use to describe this also affects, if you want, the dynamic of these organizations. Let me move on. Here, what's very interesting is this is an OECD figure that compares direct versus indirect funding of innovation, specifically business innovation, in countries. So this is government funding, like, say, this SBIR program or the NIH funding in different countries. The gray is direct. The blue is indirect, which is basically R&D tax incentives. And what's fascinating is the US, which we always, you know, again, describe as the market mechanism, actually has huge amounts of direct funding. Sweden, it's not as much as some of these other countries, but it's all direct. A country like France has huge amounts of indirect. And this is quite important, too, because coming back to this issue of these government investments actually creating these markets, what we see if you look historically at biotech, nanotech, internet, today green technology, is it's actually been these direct financing, which then create the sector, which then you can, on top of that, apply R&D tax credits. But there's very little evidence that R&D tax credits alone actually make R&D happen that wouldn't have happened anyway. R&D spending, especially the serious spending in R&D by the business sector, tends to happen in those areas where we've actually, if you want, created and, well, I hate to use it, but de-risked or de-uncertainized the area which then the business sector feels more comfortable entering, and will not spend even if, you know, taxes are very low. This is just important because of the whole Eurozone debate today. It is completely wrong to argue that somehow the southern, you know, neighbors of Germany are where they are and have the problems that they have because they spent too much. If you look at almost any of the indicators around human capital, R&D, education, these are the countries, the famous pigs, Portugal, Italy, Greece, and Spain, that have spent too little. They just completely jump out here with the gross R&D spending. But again, what's even also very important is to look at the business R&D spending. And we have lots of these countries being specifically problematic also in terms of how little the business sector is spending. Okay, so let me just quickly say something about green, and then I'll get to the issue of risk and rewards, which I want to finish with. You know, this has been a bit biased around IT and pharma, but of course the dream around sustainable growth, not just smart growth, is of course to get the whole kind of green revolution going. And what's interesting is that we're seeing very similar patterns today in different parts of renewable energy that we saw with biotech, Just again, what was the biotech pattern? It was that the NIH funded the research, basic and applied for 20 years before private venture capital sector entered. What we see in different parts of the green industry is that the upper right-hand quadrant here, so high capital intensity, high technological and market risk, is almost completely devoid of private sector financing. There's great databases if you're interested. There's Bloomberg New Energy Finance and the Climate Policy Initiative, where you can actually plot for different parts of renewable energy who's funding what. And what's actually fascinating, which is something new, which we didn't see for IT, but we're definitely seeing in green, is this emergence of public banks as being very active, right? So KfW, the German State Bank, the Brazilian Development Bank, the China Development Bank, the European Investment Bank being very active in that upper right-hand quadrant. So not just doing counter-cyclical spending, which is what you would expect of private banks to fill in the gap when private banks pull out, but also to be funneling that money around sort of the new challenges. And what's interesting, again, is, you know, this is just a fact. This is just the data, which shows basically that if you take the whole worldwide private sector, so corporate money, private equity, venture capital, and stock market, and add it up, it's about an eighth of what just these five banks have been spending on in this area. But they often also get attacked, right? So this is the KfW. Remarkable numbers here, right? Look at, this is the crisis. So the private banks pull out, right? The whole credit crunch, public bank jumps in. This is what you would expect. But it's also very much directed towards green. By the way, green is not just wind, solar, and biofuels. In places like Germany and in China, it's actually greening the entire economy. China's spending $1.7 trillion in all sorts of different sectors over the next 5 years. And if you look at the list of the seven key sectors, they're all green, but you know that includes new engines. Let me look at, this is the Brazil, but this is the China data, which is just extraordinary. If you were watching the World Cup, you would have seen Yingli. You know, it's one of the sponsors. Yingli Energy received close to $2 billion. LDK Solar, $9 billion. This is a lot of money, right? But what's interesting is that then this bank gets accused in the US of not playing fair, of if you want, going against the rules of competition. We're not supposed to have such active state financing of companies, completely ignoring, again, the kind of history that I was telling before, where the US government has historically completely picked companies, again, Compaq, Intel, Apple, Tesla, getting directly money, but also all these technologies which are in the products, having been basically state-funded. But that's, you know, there's nothing wrong with that in theory. The problem is you need a framework to talk about that. And if we actually talk about finance as being not just important in and of itself, but that what innovation needs is patient, long-term, committed finance, then the question is simply who's providing it. And if it's not going to be the private sector, so if we have VC that is in there just for the exit, has to happen in 3 years, well, you know, no shit, Sherlock, you're going to end up having to get it from the public sector. So either we need a more patient, long-term committed private sector, or we shouldn't be so surprised that both historically, but also increasingly, because of this financialization problem, we're having these active public agencies having to also pick up the bill. And this really brings me to sort of the last part of the talk, which is that right, right? Because as we heard before, there is this possibility of crowding out. I've already mentioned that the whole crowding out scenario is often problematic how it's used, simply because it's a bit narrow how it's looked at. So again, if you have an existing market, an existing pizza, if you know I take a slice, that's a one slice less for you. If instead by being one of the actors that makes that pizza's getting larger. This was Keynes's point, right? That when you have underutilized capacity, by getting government to step in through the multiplier effect, you get increasing GDP. And so increased also savings for both government and the private sector to be using, then you have this crowding in phenomena. But even that, it's limited, because Keynes didn't talk about innovation. So it's not enough to talk about crowding in. This is why I said before we need actual indicators that show us the degree to which these investments are actually creating spaces that wouldn't have existed without that kind of spending.
Of course, the counter scenario would be, okay, fine, the government just happened to do the internet, but it would have happened anyway. You often hear this, okay? It's very hard to argue, but one could argue that. But this is the real issue, which is that many of these investments that I mentioned before actually were also an outcome of an active private sector, right? So the most obvious one was Xerox PARC, which was an R&D laboratory within AT&T, which alongside the government made, you know, huge investments, which were, you know, led to the whole sort of IT revolution. And the problem with financialization is today in energy, for example, if we think of green as the next big thing, we don't have an equal commitment towards reinvesting profits into the real economy by lots of the big players. So Cisco spends 150% of what it spends in R&D on areas like share buybacks to boost stock prices, stock options, executive pay. Apple, that did no share buybacks with Steve Jobs under Tim Cook, you know, immediately, that was his big new thing, $60 billion share buyback scheme. Pfizer and Amgen have both, for the last 15 years, spent more on share buybacks than in R&D, except one year, 2004, it was a standout year. And so this really brings us, well, sorry, this is just public versus private sector spending and energy. So this brings us to the whole issue of, you know, what kind of ecosystem should we be building and why this, you know, share buyback, for example, data. To me, this is just a proxy of the problem, is problematic. This black line here being the relationship between repurchases, so share buybacks and R&D. If you look at when it started, 2003, peaks in 2007, it's actually still increasing. There was a whole issue of The Economist last week dedicated to this. You know, this is a problem. This is just one proxy, by the way, of the problem. There's other proxies one might use of just how financialized real economy companies have become. And the issue then is, you know, what to do about it. So it's not enough to have these illuminated figures like Bill Gates and energy actually admitting what many won't admit, that we need government to take the lead. We actually also need that illuminated business figures, if you want business figures, to also consider just how much sort of they should put into the box. So Steve, Bill Gates is the head of something called the American Energy Industry Council in the US, which is arguing for more public spending. It's seven companies that run this council, and those seven CEOs, those seven companies alone have spent a huge amount on these share buybacks at the same time that they're asking government to spend that extra billion. And so this is why I keep arguing is we have to not only, you know, talk about specific types of ecosystems, but actually also really explicitly admit the level of risk-taking that has been required by government to actually have the emergence of nanotech, biotech, internet, and today green tech. And so to stop just talking about socializing the risks, but also to admit that we must socialize the rewards, which, by the way, in countries that still have functional tax systems like your own, is easier. But otherwise, what you end up getting, and sorry for all this text, but it's just showing you that you end up getting situations where you have drugs, like this particular drug that's talked about here, being funded by the public sector, and then the taxpayers who funded it not even being able to afford it. Even if you have a welfare system where it's the government funding, say, something like the National Health Service, it's still the state, if you want, paying twice. And I'm not going to talk about this. This is Piketty's figure here. My argument is basically that that line that he talks about increasing inequality has actually been driven hugely by these dysfunctional, if you want, narratives of who's driving innovation. So capital gains in the U.S. fell by 50% from 1976 to 1981, because the National Venture Capital Association was describing themselves as the risk takers, the knowledge creators, the innovators, and then managed to get that tax lowered by 50% in 5 years. It was actually that association that lobbied for it. This has been documented by different people. Anyway, so I'll just finish with this, which is to say, why is all this important? Because if you actually know anything about innovation, it's not a random walk, it's cumulative, it's path dependent, it's persistent. And so unless we admit who the different collective actors are, what we've been seeing we get is some coming in, if you want, in the middle, and being able to reap the entire integral of returns under this curve, instead of just their, if you want, you know, marginal contribution, because venture capital is important. Individual entrepreneurs are important, but they are not the whole story. And the state, in fact, is fundamental in creating this, if you want, pot of profits underneath. And we need to think much more realistically how to distribute those profits, not out of charity, but out of, you know, making sure that we have enough money for the next round. Either we just print the money or bring tax back to what it was under Eisenhower, communist president, right? Republican general, 90% upper marginal rate. Or we should admit that maybe it's fine to retain some equity in the kind of Tesla type investments. Maybe we should have income contingent loans like we do for students, for companies, or have these state investment banks that are treated literally as investments with a portfolio where some of the upside from the success can fund the downside. And only in that way will we start really, if you want, dismantling this completely mythological contrast which keeps feeding so many policies like R&D tax credits, or in the UK, this new patent box, very stupid policy that we've just introduced, which is not understanding where innovation comes from and continues to assume that we just need to somehow, you know, facilitate things for business because they are the ones, as opposed to just one of the many different actors required in a functional innovation ecosystem. I've gone over, sorry. Okay.